Okay, some of your friends asked me how you're going to do ago, something like that. So, two multiple choice questions. Can I ask you the question on derivatives? Yes or not? Come yes? I will not. So, there are, the theory is tested through the multiple choice questions. So, I will not ask you for theory purpose to show me the step of the derivation. Okay? Second, do you have to do some statistical analysis for your exam? Answer. Why? Do I teach econometrics? No. You should know? Yes. So this is the, all the answer. So actually this was a question, just to let you understand, that this is a question that something similar I put in the exam last year. So this one, but the same thing that is going to be, don't practice what I give you. I always upload solutions, so do the those exercises, and I think they should, you should be made, you should do it. So let me see. I wanted that you, if you look here, these exercises here are related to the theory of capital asset transfer model. So I would like that you think about solution of point 10, 11 and 12. So read question 10, 11 and 12. Discuss the solution with your friends in 2 minutes. And then you should tell me whether these three situations can exist based on the capital asset transfer model. So, points number 10. So, expected return is 2025. Beta is 1.4 and 1.2 for portfolio B. Does this situation exist in the reality? If capital asset pricing model, or yes or not? Vabbè, the majority of you, thanks God, reply no. So this means no. Why no? So we said relationship, linear relationship between beta and the expected return. If this guy has beta higher, so if portfolio A has beta higher than portfolio B, but the expected return of portfolio A is lower than portfolio B. Since we said that the capital asset pricing model rewards systematic risk, and there is a linear relationship, I should expect that if beta of the second first stop is higher, also the expected return of the first stop should be higher. Second question: does the second question exist? If I think about the capital asset pricing, can exist if I think about the capital asset pricing model?
Yes.
Who said yes? Why?
Standard deviation is for the total risk.
Oh, thanks God.
And is for only for the market risk.
So, this, as your friend said, if you remember, if I look at the variance of my portfolio, the variance of portfolio has two components of risk, systematic and firm-specific risk. Since the capital asset pricing model only rewards the systematic risk, I can have a situation like that. As long as the beta of the second stock is higher than the beta of the first stock. Why? Because here in the standard deviation I also have a firm specific risk component. So this firm risk specific component can make the standard deviation higher for the first stock. But for the capital asset pricing model, we don't care of firm specific risk component of risk. Remember these guys here. We don't care, zero. We don't reward for this. So as long as beta is proportional to the expected return, the second situation can hold. Okay? Is it clear? Standard deviation include both systematic and firm specific. So eventually, the firm specific can put standard deviation higher for the first stock, but it doesn't mean that the capital asset classes do not hold. We don't care of firm specific component that is included in the standard deviation. This component, these guys here, can hold, in your opinion, how can I know if it's hold? So here I have three components. I have expected return of stock, risk-free rate, and standard deviation. What can I calculate with the expected return, return of the risk-free asset, and standard deviation? If I combine these three information, what I can calculate? Which index can I calculate? Ratio.
Surplus.
Oh, yes, thank you very much. So yes, what I can do? I can calculate the Sharpe ratio for the market and the stock A. And the Sharpe ratio, if should be higher for portfolio, for market portfolio, for the stock A, if the capital asset pricing model hold. The optimal portfolio, and the the sharper ratio determines the inclination of malign. So if the capital asset pricing model holds, the sharper ratio of my market portfolio should be higher than a random individual stock, because it's on the official frontier by assumption. So if I calculate the sharper ratio here of the market portfolio, is like this, 12/18, so you just take the number, minus 0.10, divided by 0.24, and this is equal to 0.33. If I do the sharper ratio for a stock A, it's equal to 0.16 minus 0.10, divided by 0.12, that is equal to 0.5. So does this situation is consistent with the capital asset pricing model? No, because the sharper ratio is lower than this. And this is the, if I take the market portfolio, just a stock A, by assumption the market portfolio should be on should be the optimal portfolio. If you check the slides of week 7, we know that the tangency point is, this is why you need to know the derivation. Not because it's important to know the step, because if you remember to calculate the tangency point, what we have done here, yeah? Try to identify the line that has the maximum sharp ratio. So the scope was to maximize my sharp ratio. If you go back to the slide. So, margin portfolio, higher sharp ratio? No. So it doesn't hold. Bene. Let's do another questions. I will upload also the solution. Question? No. Good. So now we can also see, since you are in the mood of doing exercise, I see, and you speak a lot, I will ask you to do look at question number 20. Something like that was also in the exam in the past. I need to check on that. Okay, allora, here you have, it's a simple exercise. So have a look at the question number 20. 2 minutes to have a look at question number A, B, and C, and then we will discuss together, because then we don't have more time. So we do the exercise number 20. Question number 20. So what if I want to know who was better so if someone was able to identify a very good nice stock, what I should look at? How can I say if someone was able to identify an overpriced or underpriced stock? Now, so we are speaking now, is an application of the security market line. So here we say that if everything is fairly priced, should be on the line. But if everything is fairly priced and there are not investment opportunities, why people should spend time in fundamental or technical analysis? So there is the possibility to find some alpha that can be higher or smaller than zero. And in this case, I can get an idea of what is a good investment or a bad investment. So I can find something that is that has a price lower or higher than what was. So if I can get a return that is higher than the expected return, this means that my alpha is bigger. So eventually, if my alpha is bigger, this means that I hold an investment that is doing better than what was expected. So the expectation that you have is based on the information available in that time. So but what you realize, so this is the actual return, can be different from your expectation because, based on the information available, you expect to get 16%. But in the reality, because you were able to find a very good opportunity, something that is under-evaluated by the market, you can find a stock, you can buy a stock that eventually can perform better than the expectation. So, can I tell which stock is better, can I tell which investor was a better selector of individual stock here? Or do I need some information that is missing in this question? So, if I want to do the return of my stock, then here I want to see what is the difference with my expected return. So here we said it's the first guy, the actual return is 16%. So if I want to understand who did better, I need to compare this return with the expected return to see whether this return is higher or lower than the expected return. So if I look at the information that I have here, what I have? I only have beta. If I know beta, can I calculate the expected return or do I need more information? To apply